Welcome to Tagata Pasifika. On tonight's show, we celebrate Niuean language.
It's very important to me. It's my Tonga and it's the treasure of Niuean.
Samoan culture is the treasure of the Tatau dance group.
We like to live up to our name, Tatau. It's quite difficult because you have to have one.
And Malcolm Lakatani shows us how to catch a coconut crab on the soon-to-be-launched Coconet web series.
Number two ungas, people. All right.
But first, our Filipina and Anai Arthur Anai have been re-elected onto the Auckland City Council following Saturday's local body election. It's familiar territory for the pair, but for others it was like their first day at school. A number of fresh Pacific Island faces have won a seat on their local boards. Senator for Lover Sanele Chadwick caught up with a couple of candidates adjusting to their new role.
Whanana FSL Collins is slowly adjusting to his new role as a local board member.
Yeah, I'm quite excited. I feel quite humbled that the community has given us full endorsement, especially for the Labour candidates in Ōtara.
It's the first time Collins has been elected onto a local board, and despite receiving the most votes for the Ōtara division, he admits he was a little nervous about Saturday's election.
I wasn't as confident as the others where everyone said, oh, no, we've run a really good campaign, but I wasn't so confident. I thought, oh, we'll just see how we go.
Collins now joins a number of other Pacific Island candidates to be elected onto an Auckland local board for the first time. They include Lotu Fuli from Ōtara Papatoetoe, Nick Bakalich from Mangere Ōtahuhu, Obed Unasa from Maunga Kiakia Tamaki Subdivision, and Simon Matafai and Ruby Manukia Shumkill from Fou. It's an exciting time for Manukia Shumkill, who's had to wait 3 years after narrowly missing out in 2010.
Yeah, I'm nervous, but I'm excited. So I know I've got a big job ahead. I've got a lot of communities that I need to represent, and I've got to be transparent and accountable to those people who voted and elected me in.
It's big shoes to fill for some, but Colin says Auckland voters have made the right choice.
Auckland's got to think about what it wants to look like in the next 10 to 15 years, and it has to be browner, and it's got to be more diverse. And so, whilst there wasn't a huge turnout in this election, I think we've got to do better to making sure that the community can see themselves reflected in the people who are standing.
And while Auckland mayoral candidate Uesifili Unasa didn't get elected, Collins says he's normalised it for Pacific people to run for higher office.
And I think that was great for the city, because I think we need to say to the people of Auckland, we're equals, we are equals in this partnership, we are here to stay.
Also, our congratulations to Whaono Ken Laban, who's gained a seat on the Greater Wellington Regional Council, as well as the Hutt Valley District Health Board and the Hutt Mana Charitable Trust.
The bombshell news of the week, though, was the revelation of Auckland Mayor Len Brown's affair with Bevan Chuang over the last 2 years. City ratepayers are questioning his future, including many of the mayor's staunch supporters, the Pasifika communities. I spoke earlier to the unsuccessful mayoral candidate and the chair of the now-dissolved Pacific People's Panel, Reverend Uesifili Unasa. Whakalofalahi atu, Reverend. What do you think of the Len Brown affair?
Well, it's a very sad affair in terms of him personally and also for his family, but also it's sad for those people who have been affected by it, and also the voters of Auckland, as well as our own Pacific community.
Okay, you've been out there speaking to the people in the community. How are they taking it?
Oh, I think the community is reeling from the news. They certainly trust and love the mayor, not just during the Super City years, but prior to the Super City with the Manukau, with the South Auckland community. And, you know, the contrast of someone that they trusted, they felt they knew personally, a family member really, and also someone they held in high regard for many, many years, and then suddenly something that's out of character, or they thought it was. So I think there's a sense of being let down, there's disappointment and there's hurt, all of the emotional stuff that people are feeling, I think, is very real, particularly for our Pacific communities, right across Auckland, not just South Auckland.
So what do you think Len Brown's going to have to do to win their confidence back now that he's been elected?
Well, you know, exactly what you're saying. Len Brown has been democratically elected and fairly elected, so the mayor is there legitimately, and we need to support that. We need to honour the process. My view is that we need to get behind the mayor doing his job and allowing him to do the job, because the issues are very big. Unemployment, overcrowding, housing, poverty, the Southern Initiative, the living wage, all of these issues are really, really critical for our Pacific community. And the mayor needs to deliver on that, and we need to let him do the job.
Right, and we also know that Len Brown has a Matai title. Have there been any calls for him to surrender that?
Well, I think the issue around the title is a family issue. The village that bestowed the title on him. My sense is that some of the concerns that has been aired and expressed has been around the protocols of titles and really the mana of Samoan culture. When the honour has been given and then it finds itself in this sort of situation.
Right, and had this scandal broken before the elections, do you think maybe you would have had more Pacific votes?
I think that's the question that we may never know the answer to. The reality is the election has been held, the result came out, and the mayor has won it fairly and democratically, and we need to look to the future, and that's my view. We ran a good campaign, we did what we could have done with the resources that we had, but the mayor has won the election. There are issues to be addressed, and he has to deliver on those promises and the work that's before him.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Unasa.
Thank you.
It's an important week this week for our Niuean community as they celebrate Wangahau Niue or Niue Language Week. In New Zealand, only 1 in 4 Niueans can speak the language.
Among New Zealand-born Niueans, just 11% can hold a conversation in Niuean. Doing their bit to keep the language alive is an after-school program at Favona Primary School in Mangere.
Whakalawhalai atu ko I ngā hako ko Javan Matamalui. Whanau au he anga ko Favona Primary School. Nofo au I mangele, hau au he maanga ko hakupu I niwe.
Nine-year-old Javan Mautamalui is confident in his Niuean language and conscious of its importance.
It's very important to me. It's my taonga and it's the treasure of Niue.
Javan's mum says it's been important to maintain his identity.
Ko mena I ne matalo hea I au, mai Fia fia mai manako ke matutua ke tau whakakoanga halaua whakaniwe.
Javan also learns Niuean at an after-school program at Favona Primary School in Mangere. Twice a week, around 25 students meet to learn the language under the guidance of Milene Maia.
Ka tau whanau koe ha mautoru a tau a mamana ki anga koe ha mautoru fuki a manako ke tau whanau ha mautoru koe tau whianga ki he wangahau niwe.
The class has been taught here for the last 7 years. It's partly funded by the Ministry of Education. However, the funding from the ministry is finishing at the end of the year.
Ki ai whaito tōngi a mautoru e tau matakainanga ne tau se wahanga wangahau niwe ke matutaki aki e whakaholoanga ne ke tau whanau ha mautoru I whabona.
The only other Niuean language program like this at primary school level is taught at nearby Koru School. Its funding from the Ministry of Education is due to end in July next year. It's bleak news for these Niuean students and for the future of the language, with only 11% of New Zealand-born Niuean speaking it. Mele says she's trying to be optimistic for the language's future.
Kai taha ni mena, koe kautū ni e wangahau ni wei, ka eke kua whakaako ke tau loto kaina. Ka eke ke nā kai maua he tau whanau he tau kaina, ko whē whuki e mena ke oala tūru ki ai, tau whakaholoanga pe henei tūngai whāwana, koe puhala ni a ia ke mātū taki aki e whakaakoanga he wangahau ni wei.
And Kaula Kane from the Ministry of Education says more than 20 Pacific after-school programs are funded. Seed funding worth $500,000 over 3 years is used to get them started before they fund themselves. Favona Primary Schools had 6 years funding for its Niuean language program, and Koru Primaries has been funded for 2 years. When funding at these two schools ends, the money will be used at other schools for new Pacifica initiatives. Bangahau Niuea is also supported by other ministry initiatives.
Coming up after the break, dance, traditional styles from the Tatau dance troupe.
We go anywhere, like we've been to Germany, people saw that it's better, so we're meeting. People clicked straight away, oh, Samoa, Samoa. So it's very important for us as an identity.
Welcome back to Tonga's Pasifika. The 14th Rugby League World Cup will kick off in Great Britain later this month.
There are five Pacific teams competing, and this week, Tonga's national team known as Mate Maatonga brought World Cup fever to South Auckland ahead of the tournament.
It's a star-studded squad with huge ambitions. Karima Fai'ai caught up with the team and their passionate fans.
It's a welcome fit for royalty. These Tongan Warriors are off to the UK for the Rugby League World Cup. But today, they're dropping by Auckland to rally some last-minute support.
Oh, the reception's been great, mate. Good just to see how spirited and how faithful they are in the success we may have, and it's going to be something we take with us.
It's no surprise that these fans are keeping the faith. This is arguably the strongest side Tonga's ever produced for the tournament, featuring a list of big names, including NRL champion Sydney Roosters player Daniel Dubow.
Yeah, we're feeling confident. Everyone's getting along fine, and yeah, we've been bonding well, so yeah, hopefully we can put that on the field and yeah, we'll go well.
Despite their underdog status, expectations are high as the team aim to go all the way.
We've got to start small, start from our preparation and just win the first game, and hopefully we'll get a chance to play the Kiwis and then go win the World Cup, so yeah.
So as you can see, the community have turned out in numbers. People are dressed in red with flags and painted faces. For many, this is the closest they'll get to the World Cup.
It's very important to us, especially when they leave New Zealand, UK, how there's no much support as us over here in New Zealand. So we give them all our support and everything.
Support that will surely motivate the team to bring home the World Cup.
Comparing it to the other teams, our boys are mighty strong. If they can beat Samoa, they can beat anyone else, eh? So yeah, mate maatanga o they.
Definitely looking forward to that. An island dance group is getting ready to give Asia a taste of Samoan culture.
Tatau dance group have been around for 5 years, but only recently have they received international attention.
The group performed at the Frankfurt Book Fair in Germany last year, and now they're getting ready to travel to China. Sena for Lover Sainele Chadwick reports.
Tatau dance group working up a sweat ahead of the week-long New Zealand Music Festival in Shanghai next month.
This is a blessing because we have been working really hard over these years to actually create this brand and trying to showcase their talent through traditional Samoan dancing.
Alipati Tupola has been with Tatau Dance since it began back in 2008. Dancing is his passion, and being part of the group reminds him of where he comes from.
When I just moved from Samoa, I felt homesick. I wanted to stay connected to my culture, and me and my older brother joined the group in 2008. And we thought it was just be a way of stay connected, you know, to the whare Samoa.
And it's that connection that's allowed Alipati to travel around the world to show off not only his dancing, but his traditional Samoan pea.
We like to live up to our name, Tatau, obviously. All men with full body tattoos, and it's quite difficult because you have to have one to be in the group, and it's been a mission, especially when recruiting. But yeah, it's a must to have one before you join the group, yeah.
It's a painful initiation process, but one the boys wear with pride.
I mean, if you go anywhere, like we've been to Germany, people saw that it's better, so I meet you. People clicked straight away, oh, Samoa, Samoa. So it's very important for us as an identity.
But getting inked up and being able to dance with just a lover aren't the only requirements needed to join this group. You'll also need to be fit.
When we first joined, we wanted to have a high energy group, like, so that we project, you know, fast movements and stuff. And it's quite tough practicing, doing over and over again, and make sure that we hit the slaps in the right point. And so it's very challenging for us, yeah.
It's hard work, but Ali Pati says it's well worth it. He hopes other Pacific Islanders wanting to maintain their culture will give island dancing a go.
Considering that we're in a different country now, you always want to stay connected and make sure that you inspire other people, even other nations, Tonga, Fiji, that they stay connected to their, you know, dancing. So.
Like a lot of fun. Time for community notices now with a track from Bala Kalolo, Be Happy.
This week on Real Pacific, Pacific on a Plate, some of the best Pacific cuisine.
Taking Pacific cuisine and Samoan content up about 150,000 notches.
The sago?
This is so far removed from the original dish, but it's got all the...
It's got all the elements
of it.
Of it.
Yeah.
And then just a pure coconut sorbet. Have our sour footing.
Fantastic.
My take on it.
Yeah.
Ooh, that looks amazing. Now that's on Saturday at 4 p.m. on One. And after the break, more Pacific delicacies thanks to Coconet TV. Malcolm Lakatani will show you how to catch an unga.
Welcome, Malakamu Lakatani, and on my island, Niuea, true delicacy here are these things, the unga, the coconut crabs.
Welcome back to Tagata Pasifika. Next week sees the launch of a brand new Pacific online hub, the Coconet TV. It's aimed at Kiwi Islanders and will feature a number of webisodes looking at how to do things the Pacific way in the modern day.
Here's a special sneak preview of what you can expect to see once the Coconet goes live next week. From the island of Niue, here's how to catch an unga.
Welcome, Malakamu Lakatani, and on my island, Niuea, true delicacy here are these things, the unga, the coconut crabs. They lay their eggs in the ocean, but then come to land to feed on big coconuts. So today, I'm going to hook up with local hunter from Avasele to learn how to hunt the unga.
Hey, bro. We're
going to have to, like, the first bit is a bit of a climb.
Oh.
Yeah, so probably you guys are fit for that.
Oh, yeah, we're fit. We're definitely fit. We're definitely fit.
So we take off deeper into the bush, and I can't wait because that's where all the big unga live.
Bro, yeah. We've only been going 1 minute about, and I'm really tired. It better be worth it, man.
Better be worth it, no worries.
To be honest, it was a bit of a trick, and we hadn't even put a trap down yet.
I'm like making an opening, because that small opening, it doesn't allow the coconut crab a lot of time to like get all the meat out.
So it's not really going to be killed right at the moment when it's eating now. So, but it's just a trap to kind of capture them.
Cool. To each?
Unga love coconuts and they'll stay on one, clawing away for a couple of hours.
We're at our first bedding area.
All right. So, this is the secret, this is your secret place, eh?
Yeah, right.
Woohoo!
You can hook it up with me,
right? Okay. So I've hooked it on now?
Yeah, you gotta make sure, like,
oh, wasn't good enough? Okay.
Bro, bro.
including turn again.
Right, we're there.
And
then we do the twist.
Yeah. So we face it up. So when we come onga hunting, you'll get big ass fat coconut crab sitting here.
Alright, cool. That's our one. It's coming home, mama.
All good, bro.
Yeah, good, bro.
Yep. Let's roll.
If there's an onga that bites your finger, like in a that clips your finger, what should you do?
You gotta be faster than the coconut crab. Break the claw first.
Break the claw first.
Or you break your finger.
Yeah.
Better your finger than the claw, right?
Yeah, because someone had told me that too.
Luckily I asked because Bev took off and caught one, albeit a small one.
What's that there?
Don't touch the big claws. Remember, love your fingers.
I love my fingers, musician.
Yeah. Oh, what the coconut crab is doing right now, it's crying. It's also part of its defense mechanism, so it's like trying to coat itself entirely with the bubbles.
Yeah.
That's kind of like dishwashing liquid. When you try like to hold it, it'll like try and slip off.
Ah, yeah.
Yeah. But only the smaller ones do that, is not the big ones.
What should we do now?
I'll just let it go. A couple of years will come back, it's going to be a massive one. Can I get a coconut, bro? Too low.
We were now deep in the forest. Not that I was getting scared, but it always felt like we were being watched. And not just by the beady eyes of the
man. But you know, all of the almost traps, the traps that we've seen here, there's lots.
Yeah, is this like your own place or is this open to lots of people?
It's like family land. All the coconuts we've been seeing,
yeah.
Some of them are mine and my parents.
Now, what if other people came along? And
if other people come along to our land, it's kind of like, how do you say, tapu? Sacred. So if other people come to our land, the people who owns the land,
yeah.
They don't do anything about it.
Yeah.
But the land itself, the spirits might do something.
Yeah, that's some superstitious stuff, eh?
Yep.
How about we go?
Yeah.
So it's done, bro.
And we're back.
Hey, awesome time. Tired, to be honest.
We'll come in tomorrow night, depending on the tide. Because like high tide, that's when like most of the coconut crabs are more active.
Mean, bro. Nice. Well, thank you. Homo. Hey, McGill.
Yeah.
Awesome. Alright. Yesterday we put in the hard yards, setting up all the traps for our ungas. Right now, tonight, we're gonna go get us a unga. Let's go.
Get that unga.
Well, she's a full moon, and Bev says unga don't really come out in the moonlight, but I hope we get something because I'm still hungry from yesterday's work. I forgot how long the walk was, but my sweat was about to be rewarded because I was about to catch my first unga.
Ah, yeah!
It was pretty much just in there waiting for me.
Got one right here. Actually holding on to this thing really strong, really tight. But we got it.
Check it out, bro. Look at this.
I've bought one. I've got one right here.
Got the luck up there, actually.
Wasn't sure about my technique, but, you know,
yeah.
New Zealand hands. But I did okay.
Yeah.
Remember? Hello mate, we're gonna eat you. Yeah baby, one unga! Woohoo! You see one there?
Yeah bro!
Woohoo! Yeah!
Got one!
Rat!
Is it just the bait you laid up? Yeah, just the hole we came out through, bro.
Look what we did first. In Elfi, we set that trap.
Yeah.
Pangi. Now we're good. Let's go leave some for your mix. See that? Fighting with that, imagine that, that was my finger. Number two! Number two! Two ungas, people! Alright. Yeah! Where are you going, buddy? Three.
Three.
From our bangis or our baits that we set up yesterday. Look at that. Number three! Unga number three!
You must be lucky, bro.
Pretty lucky, right?
Yeah. Next time I go on hunting, I'll bring you along.
Alright. I like that thing.
If it only lasts 5 minutes.
Unga, Niuean style. We're gonna go and eat this right now. Cheer.
Let's go, bro.
Do you, bro?
Alright.
Well, we did the Niuean thing and dropped off some of our unga to our family, but we saved one for the hunters. Fire was on, liongi ke whakamunuina kei was said, and then into it, finally.
Amen. Awesome, bro. Let's do it.
That's so good.
Throw the head.
Take the head off. Yep. Oh, look at that. Man, that's so good.
I need to get like some of it. I'm gonna scoop it. The unga.
How is it?
Man, the flavors in there are rich. You definitely taste the coconut. Real creamy. And because it's like, you know, it was cooked up and heated up and stuff, when it's warm, it tastes good too.
Cheers, bro.
Cheers, bro.
Awesome.
Bro, that looks like part of your hair.
Unga, it's so good. It's the best in the Pacific. Cheers again, bro.
Cheers, bro.
Thank you.
Niuean style.
Niuean style.
We have more coming up soon about what the Coconet is, and you can check it out online at www.coconet.tv from Friday, October the 25th.
Well, that's our show for this week. Next week, we have a special on legendary All Black, Brian Williams.
It was always a great dream of mine to play for the All Blacks, but the significance of going to a country that had the political system of apartheid was probably a pretty daunting prospect.
Going! Williams!
I just decided that, yes, I wanted to be an All Black, but if I was to go to South Africa, then I wanted to be able to show those people that, you know, people of my ilk, could compete on the same level and hopefully better. I managed to score a try the first time I touched the ball, and I was absolutely rapt at that.
Great try in everyone's language.
What a step, true legend of the game. Remember, you can catch all our stories and find out what's happening in the community online at tvnz.co.nz, keyword Tagata Pasifika. On Facebook, just like us. And we're on YouTube as well.
Whakawelahi hakua whakalataha mai a mutolu o e tulo.
Kia monuina, have a great weekend. Tagata Pasifika, born a people pride.